Good morning, everyone. And okay, my name is Francesco Corrias, and I'm a researcher in the Department of Life and Environmental Science in the University of Cagliari. And today I want to present you my last work. We try to prepare and to characterize a new pesticide formulation based on zoxamide fungicide. And we try to assess the behavior of this new formulation in kids with tomatoes. Okay. As you know, tomato is one of the principal and most important Italian vegetable species. And only in 2018, in Italy, were produced about 4.8 million tons of tomatoes. And actually, Italy is one of the most important producers, followed by Spain and Portugal. And among the fungal disease that can affect tomatoes, we can encounter late blight and gray mold. Nowadays, among between the different approaches that we can use to defeat, to fight this disease in tomato cultivars, the use of fungicide still represent one of the major tool of the major control strategy. Between these products, the fungicide, zoxamide maybe is one of the most famous, most used, and it belongs to the benzamide family, and zoxamide is the only fungicide belonging to benzamide family. He is highly effective. He works very well against homicide species. And as you can see in this slide, zoxamide show a very high octanol water partition coefficient value. Zoxamide is very lipophilic as molecule. In this slide, I show you the mode of action, the mechanism of the zoxamide. And we can divide this mechanism in about three steps. In the first step, we have the first contact about zoxamide, the pesticide, and the cuticular waxes of the leaves of the or of the tomato berries. And we can see a first absorption in the cuticular waxes. The second step is the diffusion step, where the zoxamide pass across the cuticular waxes, goes downside in the below layers. And finally, we have the interaction with the pathogen. Zoxamide can bind in an irreversible way the beta tubulin of the pathogens, inhibiting the polymerization and the cell division, the mitosis. Which is the critical issue in this work? Why we try to formulate a new pesticide formulation? Because many pesticides, I think about the 90% of pesticide, show a very low aqueous solubility. This problem led to a bigger problem, that molecules with low aqueous solubility are hard to formulate, difficult to formulate and to handle. So in many of the pesticide presence in the market, we had to add a lot of organic solvents, coformulants, excipients, etc., leading to a final and a total increase in toxicity for human and for the environmental. So we try to think in a new technology, in something different to improve the eco-friendly of pesticide formulation. And we thought in nanosuspensions technology. Nanosuspensions were developed for the first time in pharmaceutical field in the first years of the 90s, and are defined as a submicron colloidal dispersion of pure active particle, called also nanocrystals, stabilized by surfactants, polymers, or a mixture of both. which is the properties, the main properties of nanosuspensions. When we bring the crystal size below the micrometer range, better if below also the limit of 500 nanometers, we can see a very big increase in the surface to volume ratio of the nanocrystals, leading to, according to the equation of Ostwald and Noyes-Whitney, leading to increase in both dissolution rate and saturation solubility. And finally, an increase in the adhesion capacity of the nanocrystal on the surface of the targeted insects on vegetable leaf and berries. Finally, nanosuspensions are made only of water, active ingredient, and one or two stabilizers. So we can say that nanosuspensions show a very eco-friendly composition. So in this work, the targets were three. First, develop and characterize a solvent-free water-based and low surfactant zoxamide nanocrystal formulation. Two, try to evaluate in vitro and in field if this nanoformulation can permit to us to improve the accumulation, to improve the residues of zoxamide in the different parts of tomato plants. And finally, try to understand if we can provide the opportunity of reducing the amount of zoxamide in a single dose and in the number of applications. How we can prepare the nanosuspension? Normally, nanosuspension can be prepared by two different methods, a bottom-up method or a top-down method. In this case, we use a classic top-down method, the wet bulb media milling, starting from a coarse suspension of zoxamide and after a grinding process by using this bowl media milling of yttrium and zirconium, we obtain a very thin nanosuspension. After that, we proceed by characterize the novel formulation by dynamic light scattering to assess the mean size of nanocrystal, the polydispersion index, the zeta potential, the change of the nanocrystal, and to perform a medium-term storage stability. Secondly, we perform also electron microscopy photos to assess, to confirm the size, and to assess the morphology of the crystal. Here in this table, you can see the formulation that we have prepared at the start of the study. We prepared six different formulations by using three different stabilizers in two different concentrations. And you can see as we have chosen a stabilizer, TWIN 80 and two types of poloxamer. These three stabilizers are widely used also in alimentary industry, okay? So very, very green, very eco-friendly. And in red, we can see the best formulation we obtained, and we use only this formulation for the other trials. As you can see, we reach a good average diameter of the crystals, about 200 nanometer, with a good PI and a very good zeta potential. CF and CS were the control formulation. CF is a commercial formulation based on zoxamide, a suspension concentrate, and CS is a coarse suspension, okay? Just the zoxamide in water and then a little bit of Torax. So here in this slide you can see the micrographs by Hazem of the crystals. In this part A and B, you can see the commercial formulation. You can see very big crystal with a different shape. And here you can see our nanocrystal. We surprise ourselves of the shape because we obtain these thin crystals with a acicular shape. They seem like a micro needle. Okay, Here in a glass support, and here we put the nanocrystal on tomato surface. And as you can see, we have a natural depression in the surface of tomato. And here it's very interesting, as we can see a lot of nanocrystal filling the tomato depression, no? adhering in the tomato depression. Here you can see the results of the medium-term storage stability. We take the best formulation, we stored it at room temperature for 2 months in the dark, and here you can see the results. We can see that for the first 2 months, PDI and sites were good. This slide we can pass quickly. It's just to show you the instrumental condition. We performed the analysis just using a classic high pressure liquid chromatography, Agilent. And here you can see that for the extraction, for the sample preparation, we apply the classical Quetschers method by using as extraction solvent acetonitrile. And here is the table with the result of the recovery, just to see that the extraction method was absolutely suitable for the purpose of this work. Here, I think we have one of the most important of the topic of this work, the saturation solubility test. We try to perform the test to confirm if effectively bringing the sites below the 500 nanometers, we can increase the saturation solubility of insoluble zeoxamide. And we performed the study for 3 days, just to permit to the system to reach the equilibrium. And as you can see, nano suspension effectively permit to improve zeoxamide dissolution, the zeoxamide solubility. And also commercial formulation showed very good saturation solubility, I think probably for the presence of some mix of surfactants can help zeoxamide to solubilize. And after that, we want to confirm if also it's true that when we have nanometer crystals, they can improve the adhesion on different parts of the plants. In this case, we performed the study on tomato leaf. We just performed the classic deep treatment with several leaves in a solution, in a zeoxamide solution. And we wait, this is the formula that we use to calculate these results, just waiting the leaves before and after the treatment, the deep treatment, and dividing all for the surface of the leaf. And as we can see, we have very good results for nano-P, okay, with an important improve comparing with the other two control formulation. Finally, we performed two different types of experiment in vitro and in vivo on tomato plants and on tomato berries. The first is the field treatment. We want to assess if in real condition, in real field condition, this formulation is suitable and can be used. So here you can see in the maps the location of the experiment, the field experiment. Here below, it's me sampling tomatoes at the finish of the experiment. And here you can see the condition of the experiment. This is the application dose that we find in the data sheet, in the label of the commercial formulation. And we sampling tomatoes after 5 hours. We sprayed an area just with water, an area with the commercial formulation, an area with the core suspension, and another area with the nano P80. In every area, there were about 10, 11 plants, tomato plants. And we just perform one-shot experiment. We didn't, at this stage, we didn't want to assess dissipation study or etc. We just want to see if applying in field nanosuspensions, we can have an improve in the accumulation and in the delivery of the doxamide in tomato leaves and tomato berries. So here you can see the results of this experiment. It's a little bit strange. We didn't found doxamide in tomatoes. I think probably due to or some external phenomena during field treatment. The day was very windy, and or some problem or some dilution phenomena during the treatment of the tomatoes in laboratory during the chopping process. But in leaves, we found a lot of residues of doxamide, and as you can see, we have very good results using nano suspension. Finally, we perform a deep treatment. I am a PhD in technological pharmaceutics, so my technological mind suggested me to try a different type of experiment just to see how works nano suspension avoiding all the external factors that are present in field treatment. So we perform a deep treatment in at different time and different doxamide concentration, just dipping tomato berries in this solution. I have in my data set a very big table for this experiment, but I want just to show you these graphics. We didn't find a statistical significance by changing the contact time, 1, 3, and 5 minutes. But we notice an important statistical significance by changing doxamide concentration. So in this graphics, you can see the experiment at 1 minute of a contact time at the three different doxamide concentration. And here you can see more than in field treatment has nano suspension improved really accumulation and delivery of the pesticide in tomato berries. And in conclusion, just this can to explain my conclusion, we think really that when you improve the surface area of a molecule of an active ingredient, bringing its size below 500 nanometers, you can improve the water solubility, you can improve the dissolution rate, you can improve the target adhesion, and this thing led to an increase, a total increase in the bioavailability and effectiveness of the pesticide, leading to a decrease of the, I think, of the applied dose and the number of application, and finally to an increase in environmental sustainability. So we think that not only just using doxamide, but also for other pesticide, nano suspension could represent a good alternative and a promising strategy for application in agrochemical field of poorly soluble pesticide. Thank you of all for attention. This is my mail if you need something or if you have any question.